Good morning, everyone. I almost don't want to stop you visiting. It's awful. It's beautiful, but it's awful that I have to stop you. So our prelude warm-up is found in the hymnal at number 682, number 682. It's a song called "I Am Sure I Shall See." It's from the Taizé tradition. So it's repeated. It's a refrain that's repeated. So I'm going to play it through, sing it through, and then you join me when you feel comfortable. Hopefully that's right after I sing it through. Again, number 682.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to St. Philip Neri Parish Day as we celebrate the 32nd Sunday of Ordinary Time. Can you believe it? The church year is almost over with as we start a new one on Advent Sunday. So I tell you, the year went by fast, and as it always does. Do we have visitors with us today? Any visitors on this side over here we can welcome? We got from Traverse City. Welcome. Howard, Judy, good to see you. Welcome. Anyone else visiting? Here? No. We're here? Where from? Clarkston. Good to have you with us. Welcome. Anyone else visiting today? Where from?
Grand Rapids.
Good to have you with us. Welcome. It's always good to have our visitors. They always show us that they even go to church on their vacations. Welcome. Where's Brighton? Okay, good to have you. Welcome. Let's go to our special prayer that's in the front of our hymnal and pray it together. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. My parish is composed of people like me. What it is, it'll be friendly if I am. It'll be holy if I am. Its pews be filled if I help fill them. It will do great work if I work. It'll be prayerful if I pray. It'll make generous gifts to many causes if I'm a generous giver. It'll bring others into worship if I invite and bring them. It'll be a parish of loyalty and love, of fearlessness and faith, of compassion, charity, and mercy, if I who make it what it is am filled with these same things. Therefore, with the help of God, I now dedicate myself to the task of being all things that I want my parish to be. Amen. And I have some good news to tell you about the construction. This week they're going to be putting the trusses up, so that means a roof is coming. So maybe by April we'll be using it. We'll see. Let's hope, okay? Let's turn to each other now and welcome each other to Mass. Okay? Welcome, everyone. Welcome, welcome. Good to see everyone. Welcome. Good morning. Good morning again. Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Good morning. How are you? What are we doing? Are we doing the squash or are we doing the tomato? She asked me.
I'm going to try a new one today. No, I'm going to try it tomorrow.
Remember, I have the squash. I got a lot of squash. I got a whole big box of them. Okay, whatever. Can we get a group together and do it? Get a big group together. Okay. Good morning.
And on this 32nd Sunday in Ordinary Time, our opening hymn is number 685. 685, How Can I Keep From Singing? Number 685.
And of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Beloved, in today's gospel we hear about a lady, a widow, who gives her last to the Lord in the treasury, all that she had. And so as we come here today, let's see if we can keep measuring our love for others and for God by giving our best always to God. For those times that we have failed and sinned, let's ask the Lord for his mercy. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do. Through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life that is everlasting. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks. Almighty and merciful God, graciously keep from us all adversity, so that unhinged in mind and body alike, we may pursue in freedom of heart the things that are yours. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the first book of Kings. In those days, Elijah the prophet went to Zarephath. As he arrived at the entrance of the city, a widow was gathering sticks there. He called out to her, "Please bring me a small cup of water to drink." She left to go get it, and he called after her, "Please bring along a bit of bread." She answered, "As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked. There is only a handful of flour in my jar and a little oil in my jug. Just now, I was collecting a couple of sticks to go in and prepare something for myself and my son. When we have eaten it, we shall die." Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you propose. But first, make me a little cake and bring it to me. Then you can prepare something for yourself and your son. For the Lord, the God of Israel, says, 'The jar of flour shall not go empty, nor the jug of oil run dry, until the day when the Lord sends rain upon the earth.'" She left and did as Elijah had said. She was able to eat for a year, and he and her son as well. The jar of flour did not go empty, nor the jug of oil run dry, as the Lord had foretold through Elijah. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Christ did not enter into a sanctuary made by hands, a copy of the true one, but heaven itself, that he might now appear before God on our behalf. Not that he might offer himself repeatedly, as the high priest enters each year into the sanctuary with blood that is not his own. If that were so, he would have had to suffer repeatedly from the foundation of the world. But now, once and for all, He has appeared at the end of the ages to take away sin by his sacrifice. Just as it is appointed that human beings die once, and after this the judgment, so also Christ offered once to take away the sins of many will appear a second time, not to take away sin, but to bring salvation to those who eagerly await him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. From the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. In the course of his teaching, Jesus said to the crowds, "Beware of the scribes who like to go around in long robes and accept greetings in the marketplaces, seats of honor in synagogues, and places of honor at banquets. They devour the houses of the widows and as a pretext recite lengthy prayers. They will receive a very severe condemnation." He sat down opposite the treasury and observed how the crowd put money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow also came and put in two small coins worth a few cents. Calling his disciples to himself, he said to them, "Amen, I say to you, this poor widow put in more than all the other contributors to the treasury, for they have all contributed from their surplus wealth. But she, from her poverty, has contributed all that she had, her whole livelihood." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia. There seems to be a tradition in which people from one generation to the next tell people how it used to be. You know that? And so there were lots of conversations in my family that started always with when I was your age. And my grandparents would talk about having an outhouse, no electricity, no air conditioning or credit cards. My parents would talk about the days where they had to walk to school, even in the snow. No TV, no microwave ovens, no dishwashers, no air conditioning in the car or powered mowers, and how people after Mass would often go to the cemeteries to visit their beloved dead. I'm sure that many of you had similar experiences and probably could add to my list of different things your families talked about and experienced growing up. I want you that are my age today think about the days when we were much younger and our parents took us to a restaurant. That happened far and few between because we usually ate at home. The server would always come to the table and take our drink order. And then when we'd come, set it down, it looked so good to us. We just let it sit there and we'd stare at it forever and ever and ever. And you know why? Because in my day and age, when I was young, there was no refills, free refills. And if you wanted a second drink or a third drink, you would never dare to ask your parents for another one. So you waited till your food came, and when it came, you slowly enjoyed that pop, whatever it was, with your dinner until you finished your meal. It's not fun ever to run out of things, is it, in life? Things like gas in your tank. I've been doing that lately a lot. I don't know why. Battery on the phone. Milk, juice, beer in the fridge. A time clock in a sport contest that you're losing. Propane for the grill. Formula or diapers for the baby. Money in our checking accounts. You name it. Problems always come when things run out. When they run out. In today's gospel, we heard of two stories in which we find people acting much differently, I think, than we might act. We don't seem to be concerned with how they did not have enough, but they, in many ways, knew that what they had was all they needed. Both widows in the story. And in those days, widows really didn't receive an inheritance. For them, a pension or Social Security never existed. They were basically people that were abandoned and shunned. They had nothing, no livelihood. And so we can presume in a sense that each of them was living on the edge of life, not sure what would come the next day and what would they have for the next day. In spite of this, those two women in the gospel and the first reading gave it all. Gave it all they had. That first widow with her son was down to her last morsels of flour, convinced that she and her child were close to starvation and death. And here comes Elijah, the prophet, a stranger, and he asks for something to eat. Does she tell him to go away? No. Does she make up some excuse of why she can't help? No. Does she put herself or her son first, ahead of that person? No. Rather, she simply trusts God and truly embraced the moral obligation they had in those days to take care of a person who was in need. And she clung to the words of that stranger Elijah as he said, "For the Lord God of Israel says, the jar of flour shall not go empty, nor the jar of oil for a year." And then we have the widow in the gospel who dropped her two small coins into the treasury, worth about 2 cents. No one would ever expect her ever to do that. People knew. She was poor, a widow, had nothing. And no one would have criticized her if she decided simply not to give a thing. But she decided that wasn't how she was going to approach the situation. Because even though she couldn't support anyone or anything, she wanted to put God first in her life. That was her conviction, her belief, God first. She had nothing, and yet that didn't matter to her. Her needs weren't the only thing that really mattered to her. I think today's readings really ask us to think about a few things, especially about the things that each of us have. Are we blessed people of God? I didn't hear that very good. We are blessed people. And sometimes I think we need to ask ourselves, whose are those things we have? What are they for? How attached are we to those things? Truly, where do they come from? who entitled them to us. And if we feel a little uncomfortable about those questions today, thinking about them, don't worry, I am too. We should be a little uncomfortable living in a world of plenty. Don't worry, I'm today not just talking about myself, but I'm talking about really a world that we all live in. Because we probably sometimes wouldn't have to make the decision that that woman had to make, or both women had to make. And the reason is probably because we never, ever want anything to run out. We never, ever want to get to the point where we no longer have the things we need, the things we want, the things that make our lives better, a little better, and secure. Many of us are afraid that everything is in short supply. But is it really? But are we really in short supply? Think about the things that maybe might be in short supply. Time. That's a big one for me. Time always seems to be in short supply. I never have enough time in a day to get everything done. Most busy people are like that, and I'm sure many of you can relate to what I said just now. Not enough time. Some here may have a difficulty making it with their paycheck, maybe from week to week, month to month. Sometimes it's hard to make ends meet. And sometimes people don't have jobs and they're looking for one. And if one's not in supply, without one, life is not easy. It never will be. Friends, maybe for some people, might be in short supply because they struggle making them. And don't forget all the things that sometimes we can't easily quantify. Things like patience, kindness, generosity, compassion, tolerance, mercy. These too often, I think, in our world we live in, that seems to be so hateful to these days, to be in short supply. Why is that? I mean, those are the things of God. They should be in great supply for all of us. We should want those above all things. At least when it comes to compassion, tolerance, and mercy, we sometimes act as if we don't have enough of them. I mean, have you ever said to yourself, because you get so disgusted about things at times, I don't have enough in me to forgive that person. I'm sick of talking about another person's problems. What about mine? I'm done trying to make my spouse or my friends happy. I'm tired of trying to understand people of different cultures and races and faiths. I'm not done. I'm done. I'm doing favors for friends because no friend ever does anything back for me. Yes, it seems that those sorts of things sometimes happen in our lives because sometimes we're not thinking the right way. The things of God we often give in small amounts, measure out in those small amounts, and maybe it should never be that way if we follow Jesus. Today's readings, I think, really challenge every one of us here to accept a much different reality. Are we really, really to believe that we have a God of abundance? A God of abundance? Are we willing to believe that the things God is asking of us will never be in short supply? Because, look around, He's blessed us. Will we embrace an attitude in which we give simply because we see needs? And truly, from a generous heart, we want to take care of people. We want to be the best we can. And not just be the person that does mental calculations in which we weigh everything out carefully and sometimes get stingy because of that. Are we willing to freely, freely let go of the things we can do nothing about and do something about the things we can? My friends, one story, we know how the things turned out. That woman was taken care of for a year, but we don't know what happened to that woman in the treasury, do we? We don't know if that day she went without food, or that week, or month, or if she died because she didn't have anything left. But that maybe isn't something that really we should be thinking about today. Maybe we should think about the cost there is in giving. You know, it truly costs to give something. Love costs something, doesn't it? I mean, faithfulness costs something. I mean, you could have all stayed in bed today, but you got up and got in your cars and come here because you believe. You know, things that are matter the most cost something. And somehow I know that God things never run out if we're about them. The well will never go dry. The bag of flour remains full. And that's because we have a God of free refills. Of free refills. We just have to keep asking. And if we look at our lives, he's been doing that for us for years and years. He's really blessing us. The glass is not empty. He keeps topping it off, doesn't he? God is the God that gives so much. And we know that we come here asking him to make us anew all the time, to help us to be about more than we are right now, to have the grace to be able to love a little bit more, to forgive a little bit more, to be more merciful, to truly be the people he wants us to be. I mean, if I think about it today, leaving church, I would say to myself, walking out those doors, I want to be more like those two widows. I want to be generous like they were. I truly want to have my life filled with that way of living than the other way. Because they are a great example of how to reflect God. A God who is so generous with us. Let's keep working on that. Because I think our world needs people that reflect those women. Our world needs that. Our families need that. Everyone needs that. Let's ask for that grace today. Amen.
Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God and light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Amen.
God our Father, we turn to you with these our prayers because you are the God of abundance.
That the church may be a witness to the world of true faithfulness to the message of the gospel, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the Pope, bishops, priests, and deacons may continue to preach the gospel with courage and zeal, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who hold public office may seek trustworthy guidance from the Holy Spirit in all matters great and small, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That as we look forward to the coming of Christ, we may actively build a world that seeks justice and respects life at every stage, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who are sick and suffering may be restored to health and wholeness according to the will of God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For that special intention we bring with us this morning in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died and for those written in the book of the dead may be united with the glorified saints in heaven, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. And for Donnie Darga, whose funeral we celebrated yesterday, for his daughters and his grandchildren that mourn him, that God will bless him in eternal life as he is now united with his wife Pat and his son Dale. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God our Father, bless our prayers and bless us today, visitors and parishioners alike, as we have come here giving you our faithfulness and our love and praise. Bless us as we continue to go forth into the world and make it a better place by being the people that reflect you. Answer our prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
As you are now seated, our ushers come forward. Thank you, people of God, for how you bless St. Philip Neri Parish with your generosity. Thank you.
And we sing hymn number 713, Quietly, Peacefully, number 713.
Thank you.
back to you. Pray, my dearest sisters, brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that what we offer in the sight of your majesty here and celebrating the mysteries of the passion of your Son, we may honor it with loving devotion. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For through your beloved Son, you loved the world so that in your mercy you sent us him as our Redeemer, to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you loved in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to by the gifts of yours that we lost in sinning by disobedience. And so, O Lord, with the angels and saints, we praise you, as in one voice now we all acclaim. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving you thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of of faith. Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking in the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Jeff our Bishop, all the clergy and religious, and all the priestly baptized people of God. Remember today Ron Farnowski and Mary Cahon, your servants called from this world to yourself, and all of our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face, and have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, with St. Philip Neri, St. Rita, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare now to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us share a sign of love and peace with each other of Christ.
Lamb of God, you
Behold, behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed. And may the body and blood of Christ bring us all to everlasting life. Amen.
For those with us on live stream or who cannot receive at this time, an act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Distribute the body of Christ. Distribute the body of Christ, Jenny. Mark the body of Christ. Judy, the body of Christ.
Amen.
Howard, the body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ. The body of Christ, Roger. Kelly, the body of Christ. Max, the body of Christ.
Our communion hymn is found in the hymnal at number 47. Number 47. The Cry of the Poor, number 47.
The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Thank you.
Nourished by these sacred gifts, O Lord, we give you thanks and beseech your mercy, that by the pouring forth of your Spirit, the grace of integrity may endure in those whose heavenly power has entered. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And a few reminders as we go forth today. First off, keep dropping off those returnable cans for our youth group's fundraiser. Those are at the ends of the doorways there. Mark your calendars. Our Come to Christmas Festival is coming up on December 8th. Cost will be $35 per person, $280 for a table. Reservation forms are at the bulletin stands in the back of church today. Right now, we have only 5 tables left, so we're almost sold out already. So might want to get on that right away. Our OCIA classes, order of initiation for adults, is starting on, it started this past week, and Cheryl has that Thursday mornings at 10:30 if you want to learn more about your Catholic faith and a renewal or become Catholic. That's there for you. For the next 8 weeks, we're hosting our parish ministry fair. For these 3 weekends, we're focusing in on outreach ministries here at St. Philip Neri. At the back table there by the statue of St. Joseph, you'll see forms for the cemetery committee. We need helpers with that. Jail and prison ministry, out and about fellowship, and the new parishioner welcoming committee. Stop by the table for more information there today. Thursday Mass this week will be at the nursing home at Maple Valley at 10:30 in the morning. Our people that are there always are so thankful to see people come and be with them for Mass. This Thursday, November 14th, you can support the Justice and Peace Advocacy Center by shopping at Oriana Community Co-ops. 2% of the sales goes from the store to our Peace and Justice Advocacy Center that Father Wayne is the co-founder of and president of JPAC, which helps our people that come here from other countries to get started and start a life here. Sign ups for our annual Empire Methodist Christmas luncheon happens on the December 3rd, Tuesday at 11:30. Those sign up sheets are at our bulletin stands today. And next Saturday, the 16th, Cedar Maple City Lions Club is hosting an all-you-can-eat chili supper from 4 to 7 p.m. More information is at the on the bulletin board today after Mass. Look at that up, okay? And thank you all for being here and making this liturgy so beautiful today. And Linda's shaking her hands. She wants you to all know comfort, coffee, and donuts, everyone, after Mass in the Family Center, okay? Thank you all for making Mass so beautiful. Have a great week ahead, everyone. This is that gloomy time of year, and I know I see our hunters are out there getting ready to take Bambi home, but
better Bambi goes home than goes into our cars, right? My car seems to be a target, seems at times. I don't know. Okay, it's fixed now again. So have a great week, everyone. Let's bow our heads praying for God's blessing. May the Lord always bless you and keep you. May he let his face shine upon you. May the Lord always walk beside you. May the Lord always bless you and keep you. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And to our parents that have the children that are making little extra noises today, thank you for bringing them.
Yep.
I love those little voices. Thank you. Thank you. Let's go forth from here glorifying God with our lives.
Thanks be to God.
And we sing hymn number 828, Prayer of St. Francis, or Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, number 828.
Make me a channel where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, faith in you. Make me a channel of your peace. Barren life, let me bring a hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. Oh, Master, grant that I may never see so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
That's one of those beautiful songs. It says it all.